The cultures don't take recourse to that. The moment somebody, this is an experiment we did, your colleague Rajanayak knows this because he was doing an EFLU at the time. The anecdote was that this Banjara singer, Bhat, was able to sing beautifully, but he took to writing. Somebody told him to write down his songs. The moment he took to pen and pencil and paper, he forgot how to sing. That's what happened. So these biocultural formations and the cultural forms that they generate do not seem to require the concepts that have been institutionalized. Concepts like aesthetics, art. There is, you won't believe it when I say this, but show me counter evidence, I'm very happy to accept. There is no concept of art in the Indian, contemporary Indian. Everybody has written tomes and tomes of books about Indian art and Indian aesthetics. Institutions like IGNCA, Indira Gandhi National Center for Art, and Sahitya Academy, and a whole range of other institutions that continue to generate year after year huge loads of books, but there is no concept of aesthetics. Nobody has been able to define a concept of aesthetics in the Indian tradition. There is no point in simply saying Saundarya Shastra. There is nothing like Saundarya Shastra in Sanskrit intellectual history. Nobody has written Saundarya Shastra, to my knowledge. Saundarya Lahari is there. Saundarya Shastra is not there, to my knowledge. So the concepts that we think as sacrosanct do not seem to have any significance in the cultural experience that is available here. So why is that so? I think these questions will have to be asked by any researcher. The part of the reason is that why is it we continue to be what I call mnemocultural? The cultural memories that articulate by means of speech and gesture, song and recitation, because our poetic and reflective traditions are musical. Our poetic, we do not have a great significant division between poetry and music. Our songs are musical, obviously. Our poetry is also musical. Those of you, probably this generation may not be familiar with that. You can't go to a class of Hindi or Telugu or Tamil or Malayalam poetry class where the teacher is reading the text. These days it might be happening. But always my teachers used to recite the poem without even looking at the book. Sing the poem, as it were. That is a practice that can be seen even to this day in some small rural places. Yeah? Why is it the poems are sung? The poems are always sung. I think the Indian film makes use of that. In fact, one of our students is working on this. When the Telugu Mahabharata is played out, the poems are taken up and they are sung. Beautifully they are sung. Why does this happen? So the song, as you know, those of you who are doing translation studies will know that song and music are the most resistant compositions for translation. Nobody can translate Allah. Try and think about translating Allah. Non-semantic, but significant, emotively significant communications cannot be translated. And our traditions, that is that Indian reflective traditions, make use of this particular kind of element. These will have to be rendered acoustically, performatively. Somebody has to perform it. A dance will have to be performed. You can't simply practice dance by watching YouTube videos. Your body will have to start functioning. That's something that is very well known. So what is significant for this research project and this argument that we are building here in this university is that mnemocultures, cultures of memory, which are not peculiar to one region, Sitapalmandi alone, but this can be explored in the context of the Northeast, where our students are doing research in this area, in this very university. Northeast or Southwest or Rajasthan or Madhya Pradesh, any of these places. We have a cultural map that we have developed. That cultural map, I'm not sure if I have time, I'll try to show you. The cultural map enables us to find out where these cultural clusters are, where the biocultural formations are, what kind of cultural forms these have generated, and what kind of a critical creative impulse that is at work in these cultural forms that generate new kinds of forms. Okay? What becomes important in mnemocultures is the body becomes important. And an alternative or a substitute for the body is resistant. Writing is a substitute for memory. That is embodied memory. That is that the moment you write something, your body, you have externalized your memory and you retain your memory externally in another surrogate body. The notebook becomes the surrogate body. Your disk becomes the surrogate body. Your pen drive becomes the surrogate body. Your computer hard drive becomes the surrogate body. Whereas when you remember it, it is an embodied memory. The moment surrogate bodies take over your memories, somebody else begins to control them and then govern them. Nemocultures are resistant to surrogate memories. That's why nemocultures do not take to inscription technologies. That is something that one can see across all kinds of cultural formations. If you come from Rajasthan, the song cultures of Manganias, Langas, and Kalberias, these are extraordinary memories that you can see. Extraordinary memories. Not just there, but not, I'm not saying privileging Rajasthan, but you go to Teyam dance performance, or you go to, you know, Purulia dance, you know, Chow or Jhumur performances, everywhere you will come across this. Indian cultural formations, as I said, are biocultural formations. That is, jatis and janjatis. They have spread across. They're heterogeneous. Genos is a word, very interesting Greek word, as you, some of you may know, which is a polysemic word, which means genre, which means gender, which means jati, which means birth, which means all kinds of things, in fact. Anything to do with emergence, okay? So these are multiple jatis and communities that have generated very divergent kind of cultural forms, and these cultural forms are still flourishing. It seems to me, and this is a claim that I'm making, and that's the basis, premise of which new researchers are beginning to emerge from this very university. The future of humanities in India is contingent upon exploration of these cultural forms. If the purpose of humanities is to think about human action, think about what does it mean to be human being, if the purpose of humanities is to think about human creation, human reflection, the simple question that I have as a researcher is that, are we, teachers and students and researchers, are we in a position to understand and address these issues in the context where we live? That is, that if the purpose of humanities is, function of humanities is to reflect on human creativity, human reflection, human action, question about being human, what does it mean to be human, with, along with others in the world, okay? If these questions are important for humanities, you can't think about humanities without these questions, okay? If these questions are important, the point that I'm making is that, are we, you and I, in a position today to ask, whether we are in a position to ask and reflect on these questions in our context? I come from Naga community, let's say. I come from Mizo community. What does it mean to be human there? There is some reflection that has taken place in the human, in the Mizo songs. But am I in a position to reflect on that and say something about it? My answer is that, my question, the question that I'm posing as a research question is that the future of humanity in cultures that have faced colonialism, fundamentally the future of humanity is dependent on addressing such questions in our locations, wherever we are, whether we are in Indonesia, Yemen, Saudi Arabia, Afghanistan, all those ravaged places, destroyed places, okay? So there, I think new researchers must emerge, and the researchers alone will provide a possibility for thinking in a different way and transforming the ways of thinking. The transforming the ways of thinking are connected with transforming the modes of being also in the world. This is just an idea about how in the Indian context these have spread. Whatever the kind of cultural forms that have been generated, these have moved across jatis, across languages, across a communication system. Something that has been generated in, let's say, in a verbal form, that moves into a certain kind of performative form like dance, that can move into visual form like sculpture or other visual form like painting. There's a certain kind of what Jacobson calls intersemiotic translation. There is something much more interesting happening here than what Jacobson has been able to say in the Indian context. When you begin to reflect on the kind of transference of something that has happened here, the logic, we identify a particular kind of logic, the logic that enabled these transfers to take place is called what we call responsive reception. That is, that a something that comes into existence, a creative thing that comes into existence, another community or another genre or another period appropriates it, receives it, but in the process of receiving it, transforms it. That is how Vyasa's Mahabharata has been transformed by Pampa, for example. He receives it and transforms it, puts the signature of China, Jaina thing on that. Similarly, Nannaya does in Telugu. He receives it but transforms it. It's an independent work. These are called responsive reception. These are not translations. The translation, again, is a completely quintessentially Semitic term. It's a Christian term. Translation means elevation of soul from the decaying body. The body is the text, soul is the essence. That is the fundamental notion of translation. I mean, those of you who are interested in translation theory must know something about it. Critical intellectuals like Walter Benjamin, Paul Dimar, Jacques Derrida, all these people continue to function in dealing with the question of translation within this particular theological frame. That's something that theological frame is not cultural universal, that everybody will have to think about translation only on the basis of this particular argument. So the arguments about fidelity, infidelity, or fidelity or betrayal, all these kind of sexist terms that come into translation theory become irrelevant here. Kumara Vyasa declares that he is better than Vyasa. What are you going to do about it? He rewrites it. He recomposes it. Nanaya not only receives Vyasa, transforms him, adds a commentary to him, adds something much more that was not possible for Vyasa to include. Because when Vyasa was composing for my foreign other students, other than Indian students, I don't want to appear as if I'm becoming monocultural. We are talking about an extraordinary composition that spread across communities, over millennia, across various languages, across various communication forms, across performative forms. This has happened. And this composition is called the Mahabharata. So when Nanaya in the 11th century, Saraladas in the 16th century, or Pampa in the 10th century, 9th century, 10th century, they receive it, they are transforming them. These are called responsive receptions. They receive it, they respond to it, as a result something new comes in. The same logic can be seen in Gadar's compositions also. The Naksal singer composer, same Purulia dance, takes the Mahabharata themes, transforms them, brings forth something very different. So there is another dynamic that is at work here. You don't need the concept of translation. The practices are different, and we need to develop capability to understand how the cultural creativity functions, cultural imagination functions in the context from where we work. I'm sure there are parallels to this in Africa. For example, whatever we are trying to say resonates very strongly with Ngugi's own argument about overtures. Okay, if you read Global Ethics, the more recent book of Ngugi, you'll see the last chapter that resonates. We take a slightly different path, but that resonates with that. So verbal compositions become, how much time do you have? Okay. The verbal compositions that came into existence, I pointed out earlier that Indian history, in Indian cultural history, plastic arts developed at a later period, almost 1,000 years after reflective traditions have come into existence, they turned towards the plastic arts. Plastic arts, what I mean by that is architecture and sculpture. These begin to happen around 2nd century, 1st century BC, but they are Buddhist. Buddhists were attracted to writing and the plastic arts in the beginning, but then the other tradition called Vaidika tradition, that turns to plastic arts much, much later. Very interestingly, why did this happen? As a research question, we need to ask these things. Not sentimentally, not by saying that we are superior, you are inferior, that rubbish is not going to work, it's not going to be helpful, okay? As a researcher, the task of the university is to generate new research, new researchers. Otherwise, we don't need the universities. If the language that is spoken on the road is the same language that we are speaking here, we don't need the universities, we can also get onto the roads, okay? So what happens is that these compositions, which are in the verbal form, they get transformed, they get received, they get transformed in the visual forms. So Pattadakal, for instance, those of you who are familiar with the architecture of Pattadakal, you see that there's a fascinating temple. On the whole one side, you will see this is one of the early temples which actually transforms Mahabharata into visual art. Okay? It takes one side you have Mahabharata story and the other side you have Ramayana story. Very different kind of idioms, visual idioms come into existence. Very different kind of performative idioms come into existence from Bharata's Natshastra to, let's say, Kathak or Kathakali or Kudiyattam. Radically different kind of significant things come into existence. These are what we call responsive receptions. That is that a particular community with its own jati idiom, jati cultural idiom that is available to it, it receives what is available to them and transforms them. It's not, you want to call it transgression, subversion, these words have become very fashionable, but you don't need these words. Nobody, neither Kumara Vyasa nor Saraladas, nobody was saying that they were being subversive towards the earlier text. They received them, but transformed them in such a way that the text that emerges, the composition that emerges, is a significantly different composition. And the cultures, cultural languages, heterogeneity of language, heterogeneity of jatis, heterogeneity of cultural forms have been sustained on the basis of this dynamic of responsive reception. This can be seen across all jatis and cultures. What we try to do in our research here is to map this. In other words, try to develop a map. I mean, by map, I do not want to give you the impression that the existing maps like Google Map or others or Indian Map are going to be helpful to us. We need to generate a new map. We need new kind of skills that are available to us now. The digital skills, if you like. We need a different map. Even Google Map, experimented with Google Map, it's not going to be helpful. I hope I'll find time to show that. I'll show you how these cultural clusters are composed by multiple jatis. These cultural clusters and clusters of culture generate what we call constellations. And these constellations are open-ended constellations. These connect India and your Indian subcontinent to various parts of the world, various parts of the other cultural formations. Okay? We'll talk about that. Well, what did others say about what we do? So far I have talked about, I've taken three steps. Step one was to talk about the problem, the predicamental problem that we face in the institution when we study humanities. Everything that we are doing largely is dominated by European conceptual history or intellectual history, which comes from a particular kind of religious background. That's the first step I made. The second step I made is that what we say, what is it that we do, that I tried to sketch in talking about Indian cultural formations. The third step I'm making is that what others say about what we do. As I said, that what colonialism does is to talk about your own practices in a different way. Generate discourses about your practices. Yeah? If you have read Fanon has very powerful things to say about this. First of all, what colonialism does is to instill a certain kind of contempt among the colonizer towards their own culture by undermining the culture. But we are not talking about that. We are in a different period here. You and I have not faced colonialism. We were born after colonialism was over. So we don't have to, you know, kind of fart back and then blame the others as such. What do you do in the kind of situation in which you are, where the opportunities are available? That's the challenging question for our researchers. Okay? What the Europeans have done in the last 200 years? They have multiplied surrogate bodies. These surrogate bodies are archives, libraries, and all kinds of things that they have generated. New discourses have been generated. These new discourses take away your culture from you and then begin to represent the culture in a different way. Not that it is not something that shouldn't be, that should not be done, but do they raise new kind of questions? Are these questions relevant in our context, in the context of cultural practices where the cultures are still alive? Okay, that's the question that we need to ask. There's an experimental work that Krishna, the philosopher, has done at one point. He begins to ask the question, why is it Indian institutions, academic institutions are failing? His examination was that all modern institutions are failing. Universities, colleges, schools, they are failing. Why? Why is it European institutions, academic institutions have not succeeded in taking root in the Indian context? His answer was this, that they were not speaking to the cultural experience of this country. He contrasted that with something else. He examined the performative forms and the traditions through which performative cultural forms are transmitted or trained. Sangeet, dance, these forms, they are all flourishing. Dance and gharanas and the musical traditions and performative traditions, not just talking about Sanskrit, but also whether you take about Chindus or whether you take about Dakalis or whether you talk about Bailata communities, they continue to function. They continue to sustain themselves to a certain extent because the pedagogical training, the cultural idiom that trains them is significantly different. Whereas the modern academic institutions have done something else. They are disconnected, they are not allowing us to even recognize the disconnect, the disjuncture that I'm talking about. So what is needed fundamentally is to recognize the disjuncture. The disjuncture is made possible by what the West has said about us. The interpretive, archival, philological work that the West has done. Philological, I'll give you one example. I hope there are some Telugu students here. You know the story about Vemana. I think many Telugu students have heard. Vemana is a 17th century mystic poet, if you like. Okay? He composed poems and sang These songs are even today sung by Dalit community, Madigal community. They go around in certain parts of Rajasima area. They sing. We invited them. They performed here. We have the videotapes if you are interested in seeing. They go and perform this. Okay, and the first British administrator who came to Kadapa, what he did was captured all the 48 manuscripts. He found 48 manuscripts. He put them in Madras archives. And 48 manuscripts were there. And then he brought out one edition of Vemana. He thought that's it. It is only the academic scholars, the Telugu researchers are all dying to go to Madras or dying to go to France to find the last manuscript that it was. Whereas the culture continues to flourish. They keep singing the songs. Composition after composition, new compositions come into existence. Even today people are writing, somebody says Vemana wrote 1,000 poems, somebody says 5,000 poems. Nobody knows. Who needs the critical edition? Yeah, will the Pune critical edition of the Mahabharata put an end to all these multiple Mahabharatas? Does the Purulia performer of Palas make use of Pune edition? Does the Kathakali performer make use of the Pune edition? Nobody needs them. Pune edition is one of the forms, that's all. Right? But who made critical editions important? They are needed for European scholars to sustain their academic life. Not only that, but their intellectual resources are Christian resources. Right? Christian intellectual resources, please, not sentimental. I don't mean anything negative. I'm talking as an intellectual about an intellectual tradition. Christian intellectual tradition was built on inscriptions, built on scribal culture. You have read about Oiko, you know that. The Christian entire intellectual tradition is based on manuscripts. Manuscripts were important. Sifting the manuscript, finding the correct manuscript, right text, correct text. You don't have a correct text. Vemana, Nanaya in the 11th century came across multiple texts. Abhinav Gupta writing about Natshastra comes across many, two or three Natshastra texts. He doesn't tell us that this is the correct text, this is the wrong text, this is the first text, this is the last text. Nobody says that. So what we are being told today by the what others have said about us is you have to have a critical edition. You have to have this philological work. Philology is deeply connected with theology. Okay? Philology and theology go together and they continue to dominate this. We need to find out other ways in which cultures can be sustained, cultural creativity can be inquired into. What Europe has done is to these heterogeneous cultural forms that have come into existence, folklore, anthropology, whole range of other things. They have squeezed, they have pushed our cultural forms and cultural impulses into such kind of straitjackets. It's a respectable intellectual activity, by the way. West does what it is capable of doing. Western intellectuals are doing what they are capable of doing, that what they have been trained to do. Are we trained to do something else is the question that we have to ask. Otherwise, we don't need a university. If the West has been trained on the basis of its own intellectual history, its own cultural history to do certain kind of activities, are we in a position to do a different kind of intellectual activity is the question that we are asking. While making use of, while living in the same institutional structures, that's the question that we are asking today. It is necessary to begin to reflect on the very notion of tradition. That's the primary simple thing, but complex thing that I put forward. I'm not saying that take this tradition alone, and I'm not defining tradition in a holistic, unified way at all. By now you might have noticed that I'm talking about, in the Indian context, Janajati compositions, Janajati structures, yeah, Jati structures, okay? These are heterogeneous, they cannot be unified. Nobody says that one Jati's culture becomes the Jati culture of everybody else. No, the Mahabharata of Chindus is radically different from the Mahabharata of Nanaya. There is no comparison here. Nobody is trying to compare here. Chindu never does that. Okay? So Chindu is one of the communities. Located within the European institutional structures, like the university, like the discipline of humanities, the discourses that we study, and the institutions within which we study them, we need to do something else. And that is very much absolutely necessary. And this cannot be done. And I'm glad that this is taking place in this workshop. That cannot be done without the involvement of the researchers, students, and teachers. Every researcher. When I say researchers, I'm not saying all the PhD scholars, please. Everybody is a researcher. people who are on this side, we are not there to preach alone. We have to practice. We need to do our own research. Otherwise, you won't be able to communicate. So research is a collaborative work, right? I'm not saying that, okay, research is a collaborative work, you can't come and ask me, write the four chapters. No, the second part of the thesis, I write the first part, you write the second part. That's not the one. Research is a collaborative activity in the sense that there are common research questions. New kind of questions might come into existence. I do not know anything about Bangla. I do not know anything about, Malayalam. But my researcher, my student will learn more about it. Because the questions are pushing the student to address the question. Many of the students, they are here, some of them are here. They read texts in their languages now. I'm gratified to point out, this semester some students have bought Natshastra texts in Kannada, in Malayalam, and they are reading them. Okay, and in other languages, while making use of the English one. That possibility is there in the Indian context. Indian classroom is an extraordinary classroom. I'm not saying this to flatter you, but it's also the most challenging one. Why? Because when you look at the composition of the students, it's very difficult to know what kind of students we have here. Why? They're not unified. They come from very different kind of communities. They come from very different kind of jatis. Each of these jatis has at least, minimally speaking, 1,000 years of cultural history and cultural form that they have generated. Is the teacher capable of addressing them? No. The teacher is not prepared at all. So the question is, what kind of humanities are we doing? That becomes the bigger question. So, that's for silent reading. The question is that, given the situation in which we are, what is it possible for us to do? What we can. Okay. Now, what I wish to do is to show whatever I've said so far is not my research alone. The research that is emerging here, in order to make you believe that some things are possible, practical, not simply thinking in the air as such. I want to show you something. I hope it's possible to show. I won't take much time. We were grappling with the problem of cultural forms of very divergent communities. The idea was to how to put them together, bring them together on a particular kind of accessible map. Is it possible for us to map? There are very divergent communities generating divergent cultural forms. Can we bring them together conceptually, visually, practically? So the project is going on. It's an ongoing project. And this is not a project anybody can complete it. It's an open-ended project. Anybody can plug in from anywhere. You don't have to be necessarily in the Sita Valmandi Institute. You can be anywhere and continue to work. As I said, the cultural map has, the Indian map has been differentiated on the basis of 7 constellations. Cultural clusters in each area compose a constellation. There are 7 constellations we have identified. One is called Gandhara. There are flows from Gandhara side that created the communities and jatis in the Indian cultural formation. At the same time, you see from a Brahmaputra, which is the northeastern part, Brahmaputra also brought in lots of communities from various places, from South China, from Vietnam, from Laos, from Indonesia, from various places via Myanmar and via Tibet, communities have come and peopled India. Our cultural formation, cultural forms are generated by these cultural flows. And so Gandhara and Brahmaputra are 1, are 2.